Hey everyone, how's it going? In this video, we're going to go over Python decorators, which can be super handy when you're, well, doing a lot of stuff. So let's just jump into an example. All right, so say we have a bunch of functions in our code, but we're not really sure which ones might be taking a long time, and we want to make our code better and faster, or at least understand what's taking long. So let's look at this example here. Well, first off, we're importing time and importing requests up above. We don't really have to worry about that, although we will be using time shortly. So here we have a few different functions. We have math stuff, which is just making x to the power of 2 and returning that. Hacking the internet, which is getting, in this case, google.com. And then it's waiting for some n amount of time, in this case, 3 seconds. And then we're printing done. So when we run this, it's going to, well, take some time because it needs to perform some math, needs to perform a GET request against google.com, and it needs to wait for 3 seconds. You can probably have a good idea of which part is actually taking a while, but still, it's not usually that obvious. So I'm kind of making it really obvious here just to kind of show you an example. So say we wanted to figure out what is actually taking so long. Well, one thing we can do is basically calculate the time at the start of a function and then the end of the function and print that off. All right, so then we'll do start time equals time dot time, then end time equals time dot time, and then we'll do print f string, which I feel like should always be the default, but whatever. Math took not room. End time minus start time seconds. Great. And then all we have to do is just copy and paste this a bunch in your math, right? Change this to hacking and get the start time again, walking the dog. And now if we go ahead and run this, we can see that, okay, math took 0 seconds, hacking took 0.38 seconds, so 380 milliseconds maybe, and walking the dog took a little over 3 seconds. Great. So in this case, now we know what is taking so long. But there's got to be a better way of doing this, right? Like, what if we had not just a few functions, but what if we had like dozens of them, right? Doing this would kind of suck. So there is a way we can do that with decorators. So decorators allow you to decorate a function. And when you do that, you will actually run the decorator. Well, you'll run part of the decorator and then run your function and then run another part of the decorator, depending on how you want to implement it. So let's go ahead and make ours. So we're going to create a decorator, which is just a function called time it. So what you do when you have a decorator is it actually returns a function. So we're going to create a function here called wrapper, and it's going to take in star args and then star star kw args. That way, any arguments we pass to our actual function, we can then, we're basically intercepting our function call by calling this wrapper, and then our wrapper is forwarding whatever was passed to the wrapper to our actual function. It'll all make sense in a second. So now what we can do is this wrapper is actually what's going to be called. So we can actually create our start time and then our end time right here. And then we can say that print whatever or something, which we'll get to in a second, took whatever seconds. Well, f here is the function that we are executing on. So all we have to do here is just do f star arg star star kw args, and then that's now executing the function. And if we actually want to be even better with this, which we probably should, we can get the result and then we can return the result. And then to be even smarter here, we can then do f dot underscore underscore name underscore underscore, because every function has this underscore underscore name underscore underscore. which is just a property on a function, which is the name of the function. Now, if we go ahead and return wrapper here, we are done. We now have a decorator. So we can actually go ahead and delete all of this. Let me just get rid of all these. Perfect. Now, if we go ahead and run this and then run this, nothing's happened because we deleted our code, but we haven't actually set up our decorator. So let's say we want to set up our decorator. How do you do that? Well, all you do is do at and then the decorator name. So time it. So if we now add this to each of our functions here, anytime those functions are called, we will see that our decorator is also called. And I'll kind of go over exactly how that works in just a second. So let's run this, and we can now see that everything is taking however much time, but we're not actually writing that, right? We've written it once, and because of our decorators, it's now running it all when we want it. Pretty sweet. So how does this work? All right, so how does this actually work? So the way this works is a little bit complicated, but let me explain it to you as simply as I can. So what happens when you add a decorator to a function is a little bit easier if I break it down. So let's say we have another function here called test. And this function is just gonna pass, it's not gonna do anything. Now, if we print test, what do we expect to see? Well, we see test because it's referencing the function test. And notice we're not executing this function, right? If we did this, we would get nothing because it doesn't do anything. Okay, but what if we add our decorator to it? What if we add time it? What do we expect to see now? Well, if we run test now, we actually get timeit.locals.wrapper. So what the adding the decorator of time it is doing is it's making it so that any reference to any decorated function is actually calling the function that the decorator is. And in this case, it's kind of replacing it. So how is it going to be possible that test is ever going to get run, right? If we want to print, hi YouTube, here, right? If we run this, well, nothing's happening here. But because now test is referencing the wrapper function within our decorator, it means that anytime we now try to run test, it is running our wrapper, right? So even if this takes like an input of like n, and it's, I don't know, we print n as well. N. There we go, right? If we were to do this, we would now expect that we would be able to pass in like a 2, right? But if we did this, now we're getting hi YouTube, a 2, and then test took 0.0 seconds, and then we're getting a none. This is just because we're printing. So if we did this, that's how it would look. But because just how we saw it before, where we were printing this, we saw that it was referencing the wrapper. So actually, when we call test of 2, it's calling this wrapper function with the 2 as an argument. Now, arguments here, the star args, are arguments that are passed to a function, just like this 2. And kw args are basically arguments that have a name. So if we said like name equals Jake, this would be a kw arg that you could reference. But they're kind of considered two separate things, but they're always there or present for any function. That's just kind of how it knows to be able to determine different types of arguments. So when we run wrapper, we will get the start time, and then we will call the function that was referenced from this timeit, which is this test. So when we do this, it will call test, and it will pass in the arguments that we passed to whatever we passed to the wrapper. So it's kind of routing our request through the wrapper, but because this timeit has a reference to the function we actually care about, we can then call the function we actually care about. It's a little bit of a tricky way of doing this, but it's really, really smart when you think about it. So because of this, we can then still get the result, We can still do stuff before or after we actually call the function, and then we can print out what the result actually looks like. It's pretty amazing, really. All right. So this is, I think, really, really cool. But what if we want to make it so that maybe it's a little bit more customizable, right? So maybe we can specify to what granularity we want the log timed seconds to come out at. Well, we can do that as well. So how do we do that? Well, all we have to do is just do def time it with precision, and we'll say like n equals 2. And then we're going to basically indent all of this, and then we're going to return time it. Now, all we have to do here is just do round and n. All right, now obviously time it is no longer defined. So all we have to do is just update all of these, and let's just leave it like this for a second. Now, if we run it like this, what do you think is gonna happen? Let me know in the comments if you have a guess. I'll pause for a second. Okay, hopefully you've left your comment. Okay, if we run this, it just prints immediately. It's done, but clearly it wasn't done, right? So why did that happen? Why did we just run immediately, but we didn't actually do anything? Well, the reason for that is because we are basically getting this time it with precision, just like we had it with time it before, or just this inner time it version. But when we do this, we are expecting a function to be input here. So what actually happens is a function is input here, and it's actually n. And then, like you can kind of see here, if we do this and we save and we run, we can see that mass stuff, hacking the internet, and wait are all being printed, right? Because of this. But because of how this is now laid out, we're not actually returning this wrapper function. We're never actually calling the function that's underneath. Even though we're returning time it, which is returning a reference to this time it function, it's not actually doing that, right? Because it's actually executing this time it function anytime those things are called. So for instance, if we update it to do this and we run this again, we're now effectively anytime, basically this all function math stuff, function hacking the internet, function wait, are all happening when it runs through this. And then when we actually run the function, this 5, google.com, and 3 are being printed here. But then the return of this is just returning the wrapper. It's returning another function, which is not at all what we want, because we want it to actually run the function. So all we have to do to actually make this work is make it so that instead of having it reference this function so that whenever we call it, it calls this, we want it to reference this function time it. Well, how do we do that? We get it to return the function. So in order to do that, you just have to execute the decorator because it's still a function. So if we add all of these brackets here and we go ahead and run this just to make sure that's good and run this, well, you can see it's now actually working again because, well, the default value is 2, which is what we're getting here. And now we're getting this function math stuff. Well, where's that coming from? That's because we're executing this function and we're referencing it within this, because now the return of this is now time it rather than just referencing this function. So if we go ahead and return this, now we can say that maybe we only care about the first 5 digits and the first, 4 digits, right? So now if we run this, oh, where am I printing still? Oh, I didn't save this, oops. Save, there we go. So now we can get 4 digit precision, we can get 5 digit precision, whatever we want, and it's customized to the actual function that we're calling, right? Anybody who's now calling this wait function is always going to get the benefit of this time it with precision. So in this case, we're just adding a timer to see how long a function is taking to run. But it can do anything, right? If you always want to do something before and after, or after, I guess, a function is being run, you can just add a decorator to that function and you can guarantee that that's happening. Some great applications of this are like timing to see how long functions are taking, using things for memoization, input validation, just generally like logging things, right? If you want to know anytime somebody's called your function, but you don't really want to have to write the log statement in every one of your functions, you can just add a decorator and decorate all of them and done. Pretty easy. So this was just a little basic breakdown of some of the power that you can have from decorators. We kind of went over decorators very slightly within the classes course. So if you want to check that out, just can look right up here. But again, I kind of wanted to just make sure we went over them because I think they're a really cool and honestly kind of unique thing that at least I'm aware of that I've only seen in Python. I'm sure there are things that are somewhat similar to it in other languages, but being able to do things so simply with Python to create this functionality is really awesome. So I wanted to share that. So that's all for this video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you in the next one. But remember, I'm Jake, you're awesome, and this has been Python Decorators. Cheers.